tonight when parents abduct their own children.
We knocked on the door and I thought my worst fears had been realised.
I just thought, that's it, I'm leaving. I'm taking my son and I'm running.
And what have you done to try to get the boys back?
I've exhausted just about every resource in Australia. I've written hundreds of letters.
She was quite manipulative. She told me from a very early age that my dad was an evil, nasty, violent person and that we had to go for our own safety.
What lengths will you go to get a child back?
As a mother, it's like, I want to keep them away from harm as much as I can, and that means staying away for a bit. Well, maybe that's what I have to do.
Hi, I'm Jenny Brocchi. With me tonight, a woman who was abducted as a child and taken to Switzerland, a mother who hasn't seen her daughters for 4 years, and a private investigator who does international child retrievals. Welcome, everybody. Good to have you all with us. Aisha, I'll start with you. Tell me about the last time you saw your three daughters. What happened? When was it and what happened?
It was a community event on a Friday evening. And that was when I last saw my kids and they greeted me and said goodbye. It was just one of those things that they were going with their dad that evening.
And their dad were separated? Were you divorced?
We were, yeah, divorced at the time.
Okay.
That was the last time I saw them. And it's been 4 years since then.
And he rang you the following day?
He rang me the following day and we had a discussion about trying to resolve custody issues. So there was nothing formal in place. It was an informal arrangement. And that was the last time I saw him. So he flew out of Perth on that Saturday.
And where did he take the children? How old are the children? Or how old were they then?
Okay, at the time, I was 4, 7 and 9.
And where did he take them?
Algeria.
Now, he's Australian. He's an Australian, but he was born in Algeria?
Born in Algeria. And we'd been living in Australia married for 9.5 years, so living in Australia all that time.
How did you feel when you realised he was in Algeria?
Took me a couple of days to realise. So it was by the Tuesday that it was actually confirmed that they were in Algeria. And that confirmation came from a phone call I'd made to his mother and asked for the kids. And I guess I kind of hoped that she would say they weren't here, but that she actually went to go and get them. And that was my first realisation that
they
definitely were overseas. Yeah.
Yeah. How old are they now?
So the youngest will be 9 in July, and 9... 12 and 14.
And it's 4 years since you've seen them.
That's right. Well, the last photo he sent me was in March. It was a month after they left, and that's the last time I've seen them.
Do you think you'll see them again?
I have to hope. And I think I do hope that one day we'll see them. It's more a matter of when.
Yeah. Jo, I wanted to find out a little bit about your story because you were 6 when you were taken by your mother to Switzerland. Do you remember what happened?
Oh, yeah, very clearly. So she had premeditated the entire thing for about a year beforehand, and she was quite manipulative. She told me from a very early age that my dad was an evil, nasty, violent person and that we had to go for our own safety. My mum sort of placated me. She bought me a lot of toys and things, so she tried to make herself out to be the better parent, constantly just telling me that my dad was evil.
So was she telling you you were going to do this? Do you remember that?
Yeah, she actually did tell me that we were going. She even told me that we were going to Switzerland. She said to keep it a secret from my dad and not to tell anyone, but it was basically going to be a huge adventure. I was going to go to a great new school there. I was going to have whatever I wanted and we would be away from my dad.
And what was it like when you got to Switzerland?
It was quite different to what she had made me think it would be like. We sort of lived in this studio apartment. I was sleeping on a couch for about 6 months. She had a partner over there, and it was quite difficult because it was just a complete stranger living in his apartment, and there were just no children my own age, so I was living there for 6 months basically in this little dark dingy apartment. I couldn't go out really. I didn't have any friends my own age. Just really hard, and obviously no contact with my dad. So
and you remember this quite clearly from that time.
Yeah, quite clear.
And you changed, you had your name changed.
She did it quite well. I mean, we had fake identities, different names and everything, so, yeah.
So what was your name?
She called me Genevieve and she was called Felicity.
And what was that like as a 6-year-old?
It was quite strange, like really quite strange. She let me choose my own name, so I guess that was, you know, a little bit different. It was just really bizarre, I think.
Mm. Brian, you're Joe's dad. How do you feel listening to that?
Well, it does, you know, remind me of what happened and how I went to the house where Johanna was living to collect her for the normal weekend access and not getting any answer and leaving it for a week because when a mother got her nose out of joint, this often happens, so it's just better to go away and let things cool down, whatever was upsetting her. And finally, I couldn't stand any more, so I knocked on the door and a strange woman opened the door and said she'd bought the house the week before. And I'd feared it for many years and had Johanna on the Federal Police Airport watch list for about 3 years prior. But unfortunately, the system did not operate correctly on that occasion.
How did you get it back?
That was a long story.
How did you find it to start with?
It was rather bizarre because her mother had gone to Switzerland for about 6 months beforehand, I think it was, or maybe 9 months beforehand, and she asked me to look after Johanna. She said that she had a job offer over there, and she even asked me would I look after Johanna for a couple of years while she pursued her career in Switzerland. And the whole thing smelled, you know, quite fishy. So
you were divorced at this stage?
We were divorced, correct.
And who had custody?
She did, and okay. I had weekly access. So once I realised what happened, I was absolutely shattered. From then on, I basically became a private detective. I followed all the leads. From our earlier visit, I found her postcards from one of the cities in Switzerland. So Attorney General made an application to Switzerland under the Hague Convention. They searched and couldn't come up with anything. And this went on for about 4 months.
Now, the Hague Convention is the agreement that Australia has, or that numbers of countries have, about the return of children.
Exactly.
So that those matters are dealt with in the home country, resident country.
Yeah. Yep. And the Swiss authorities couldn't come up with anything for about 4 months. In the meantime, I gave up my work and followed every lead I could. And I came across people that she'd work with, found that her life was a very strange one indeed. And towards the end, actually was quite sure that she was in America in San Francisco, to be specific, and I was even going to fly over there because I thought that's where she was. And then out of the blue, the Attorney General's Department rang me after about 4 months and said that she had in fact been located in Switzerland.
And had you given them the lead about the postcards?
Yes, I gave them all that information.
Mm. So how did you get Joe back?
I flew to Switzerland because I pleaded with them to take Johanna into care because I was sure that a mother would flee Switzerland, and once she got into broader Europe, it'd be very difficult to track her. And they were quite content that she wouldn't do that. So I got the first opportunity. I flew to Switzerland, and on the first afternoon, we went to the block of units that they had the address for, which was a very poor, rundown public housing type units. We actually found the apartment where she was supposed to be, and it was totally quiet and dead. We knocked on the door, and I thought my worst fears had been realised, that she'd bolted.
Moved.
And I was shattered. I went back to my friends. They said, well, in the evening we'll go to the police station. So I waited at the police station, and they went. They were gone for a couple of hours. You know, I was very despondent. And about midnight they came back and they said, we've got your daughter. And I was very emotional. And
So they went with the Hague Convention behind them, I guess.
Yes, I think that's the way it would have worked. But they took in Johanna into care and put her in an institution. And they made a tentative arrangement that both the mother and I would be able to see her at that institution, I think on a daily basis. In the meantime, we then had to then go through the Hague Convention.
Do you remember this?
Yeah, very clearly. Yep.
Do you remember being in the institution? Do you remember being taken there? What was that? That must have been scary.
Yeah, well, I remember the police came and found us at night time. I'd just gone to bed. And I asked my mother if I should hide under the couch, and she basically just said, no, like, this is it. We got taken to the police station by the authorities, and I was really just quite confused and upset because I couldn't speak French and they were all speaking French.
And what was it like when you saw your dad again, given that your mum had been saying all these things about him?
It was a relief because I think it's just you get kind of distressed when you're sort of with the same parent for about 6 months and they're, you know, it was quite an emotional thing living with her. She would have a lot of fights with her partner. So it was a relief, really.
Mm. Aisha, your children were taken to Algeria, as she said, which isn't part of the Hague Convention. They're not signatories. So what did you do?
Well, I approached government and non-government agencies within Australia to ask for help. And basically the answer is we can't help you because it's a non-Hague Convention country. So the advice is given then you have to go through the court system of that country and try and get the kids back.
So you travelled over there. Did you do that?
Yes. I went twice to Algeria.
And what happened?
For them. Well, my ex-husband had started court proceedings in Algeria, so we had to then defend that. So we went to the court system, which is at three levels. So the first level is just the local court, and I was given weekends and half of the school holidays, which wasn't great, but it meant that if I was there, I could see them.
As long as you were in Algeria?
In Algeria. Mm. But the problem then was we had to find them first. And we got as close to a house that he was staying in. Somebody saw him go in. We stood outside the house, knocked on the door, but he refused to open, and we couldn't get in anyway. I mean, if we could have climbed the fence, we would have, but it wasn't possible. By the time we then asked the police for help, they basically said, we need the court papers, and we didn't actually have the paper with us, so we had to go back to the original town, and when we came back, he was gone, and we couldn't find him after that, so...
Mm. And so what happened with that court process? Did you get anywhere in the end?
We got to the second level. And because we couldn't serve him with papers because they couldn't find him, they threw the case out.
So where are you up to now? I mean, have you given up?
I don't think you ever give up.
No, I just, that's a totally wrong question. But I mean, do you feel despondent? Do you feel like you just don't have the fight in you?
Yeah. I think after the last trip, which is in July 2009, I needed to take a break. Emotionally, physically, just couldn't do it anymore. And yes, I took a break from that. And just whenever a lead came up, I would then look into it.
Cole Chapman, you call yourself a child retrieval specialist. Tell us what you do.
We recover children that have been abducted nationally and internationally by a parent.
Now, you're a private investigator?
That's right. Private investigator.
So you have a private company that you do this with.
Yeah.
What lengths will you go to get a child back?
Put me on the spot there a little bit.
Well, no, tell me. I want to know what lengths you'll go to. How far will you go?
That's very difficult to answer.
Why? Why is it difficult?
Well, because sometimes rules have to be broken to get the children back from some countries. Take Algeria. With Aisha's children, we may need to get them out of Algeria and... You may have to cross a border. You may have to cross into Tunisia or Mali or into Morocco.
You're not working with Aisha.
Aisha has not hired you, so let
me make that absolutely clear.
Yes.
But OK, you might have to illegally cross borders. What else might you have to do to break rules?
Some minor misdemeanours, Privacy Act.
What sort of things?
In some countries, surveillance isn't as accepted as it is here in Australia. Following people. It's viewed as a form of harassment or stalking in some other countries, whereas in this country we have quite a lot of liberties as to, you know, how much we can surveil someone.
And are you quite happy to break the law?
Look, I think we're talking about someone's child that's been stolen, not their push bike, so under these circumstances, yes, I am. Yeah.
How far will you go, though? I mean, are weapons involved in what you do?
No child has ever been traumatised or hurt or damaged, or no parent has ever been hurt or damaged or traumatised on any of the jobs.
How do you know that?
We're in contact with the parents afterwards, the children afterwards. We're still in contact with children 10 years later that we've recovered. Many of them still send us Christmas cards. We're there present at the time. You've got a visual analysis of the situation as to whether someone's... traumatised, whether they're upset or not, or whether they're happy to actually see the parents.
Talk me through a difficult operation. Just explain for people what it would involve, what sort of things you'd do.
Taking Aisha's case as perhaps an example, we would surveil. We would attempt to locate the father and the children. We would do that by talking to family members, various government agencies. Once we located them,
if you're talking to the family members, do they know who you are, or
are you presenting yourself
as someone else?
We would be surreptitious. We would use surreptitious methods there. That would be undercover. Try to find out where they are, their habits, their behaviours, their movements. Then we would bring mum in. We always want a parent close by before we do a recovery. We would find a situation or circumstance that was not traumatic for anybody.
Such as?
Perhaps the kids were going to school. Father dropped the children off at school. We would turn up at the school an hour or two later with mum to collect the children.
And how do the children react in that situation?
I've never seen a child unhappy. Sometimes they're confused, they're a bit bewildered or shocked or surprised. But in every instance, they're over it in about 10, 15 seconds. They're happy.
Joe, how does it feel listening to that?
Yeah, I think that's obviously a much nicer way to do it than being woken up in the middle of the night and being extracted from your apartment and then going back to the police station. I think that's a lot less traumatic. Mm.
Do you ever do that, wake people up in the middle of the night, like move into a house in the middle of the night?
No. We have done some recoveries where children have been asleep and the mother or father has come in and carried the child out to the vehicle. But nothing like what Joe's talking about experiencing, no. No, that is very traumatic.
You mentioned to our producer sedation, that you've actually been involved in sedating people. Is that right?
That's correct, yeah. That's correct.
Explain that to me.
It's with prescription medication. But someone like Joe, perhaps, who hasn't seen her father for 6 or 9 months, she may have been told a lot of stories that denigrated him, made her fearful of him, made her worried about what was going to happen. We may put a mild sedative into a Coke just to relax her, because she's only 7 years old. It's very traumatic seeing Dad after 7 or 8 months. So it's just a mild sedative just to relax.
And is that something you just do, that you just decide to do?
No. It's not just a carte blanche decision. We liaise with the parent, we liaise with the doctor, liaise with the psychologist at the time.
OK, we'll talk a little bit more about the detail of what you do a bit later. But, Keith, I know that you do retrievals too. How far will you go?
Yes, I've been involved in some 30 or 40 international retrievals over the last 20, 25 years. I won't drug anyone because I don't have any qualification as a medico to assess the age of the child or what drug they can take. I'll go to the lengths of, for want of better words, set up a sting to get into a country, and I've been into some fairly terrifying countries. In fact, Yemen, to get in there, we set up as a movie production company and were shooting what they thought was a movie. We were practicing getaways from where the children were to a boat we had waiting at the Red Sea to head back to Djibouti in North Africa. Various other cases, there's been all sorts of stings set up to get the children. I only accept about 3 out of 5 cases that come to me.
Why?
Because I feel that the children are probably with the better parent after I do my own due diligence back here in Australia.
Mm. Mary in Ireland, I want to bring you in here. We can't identify you for legal reasons. You fled Australia with your 6-year-old son in 2005. Tell me why.
Because I had exhausted every legal avenue to protect my son from serious sexual, emotional, sadistic abuse at the hands of his father. And I had no other option. It was the only option that I believed I had.
What evidence did you have that your son was being abused by his father?
It was a long process of realising what was going on. I had taken him to a doctor one time when he had returned from an overnight contact visit with his father. But due to something that happened when he came home, so, yes, everything led to basically there was evidence that there was abuse, and the comments and disclosures that my son had made to myself, to family members. His behaviour was noted to be alerting people if something was wrong with him, for example, in his kindergarten. And then the actual experts that spent many hours with him came to that conclusion also.
You went to the family court and you say that your lawyer told you that your husband was likely to get unsupervised visits. Is that right? Was that the motivator for you to leave the country?
Yes, and this, you've got to understand that I went to the... I basically got sent along to the family law court by the lawyer who had done our property settlement. And by the time I decided to leave, that was nearly a year and a half later.
So what happened next? You thought that your husband was going to get unsupervised visits. What did you do?
And at that stage, something just... I just thought, right, that's it. I have done everything legally to protect a small child, vulnerable, who's been seriously abused, and nobody was listening. And I just thought, that's it. I'm leaving. I'm taking my son and I'm running, because his physical safety was at risk, very much at risk. And unfortunately, the legal system failed us extremely badly. I literally left the court at 4:30, and luckily it was late night opening, and I just thought, that's it, I'm getting out of here. And I went to a travel agent and I basically said to them that I had to get to Ireland as soon as possible. That was it, and my son and I, we left, and a few days later we arrived in Ireland.
And you were brought back under the Hague Convention, but you got custody of your son, so you've gone back to Ireland. Is that right?
That is correct, yes.
Michael Nichols, you're a QC who specialises in child abduction cases. These stories are so complicated, but can you understand why some parents would resort to abduction if they do fear for the welfare of their children?
Yes, although, as we've heard from Mary, it's often something of a short-term remedy, because in those sort of circumstances, it's no surprise that the Irish courts would have ordered the return of her child to Australia to make a final decision about who he should live with and where.
Is it a crime to flee the country with a child, with your own child, against the wishes of another parent?
It is a crime in Australia to take a child out of the country without the permission of the court or the other parent, if there are pending parenting proceedings or a parenting order has been made. But if there are no pending proceedings and no parenting order, no, it's not a criminal offence.
So anybody can take a child, if a relationship breaks down and it hasn't gone to the family court for those sort of proceedings, the parent can take the child without any consequences?
Well, they certainly wouldn't be called to account in a criminal court, because it's not a criminal offence. But the fact that you've abducted the child, unless you've got some very good explanation, may well be taken into account when the court is making its determination about who that child should live with.
Tonight we're talking about parents who abduct their children and take them overseas, and the spouses who try to get them back, or ex-spouses who try to get them back on some occasions. Matt, in Japan, you've just moved there to try to get access to your sons. How long ago were they taken to Japan by your ex?
They were taken on January the 26th, 2009.
And did you have any warning this might happen?
No, not at all. I mean, as far as I was concerned, my marriage was a normal marriage, and my wife at the time just wanted to go to Japan for a holiday. And I lived here for 10 years, so, you know, I knew how she felt. You know, you get homesick and you want to go back to your country. So that wasn't a problem, not a problem at all.
Mm. So you had no inkling at all? You don't think there was any signs?
No, not at all. I mean, looking back with 20/20 vision, you know, the pieces fit together and you can think, well, yeah, that didn't seem right. But no, at the time I had complete trust in my wife.
So what happened? She took them over there for a holiday and just didn't come back?
Yeah, well, she took them there for a holiday, and we maintained contact through telephone. And a few weeks later, she just out of the blue told me that she wasn't coming back. And, you know, That was it.
And what have you done to try to get the boys back? How old are they?
My oldest son is 11 and my youngest is 7. Well, I've done just about everything in Australia. I've exhausted just about every resource in Australia. I've made hundreds of telephone calls. I've written hundreds of letters. Unfortunately, the only thing the Australian government has said to me is get a court order and go through the Japanese legal system. But unfortunately, and I've been trying to tell the Australian government this, that court orders aren't recognised in Japan. And secondly, the Japanese legal system is a farce. No parent has ever won a court case against a Japanese parent. Not one child has ever been returned to its habitual residence. And court awards the child to the Japanese grandparents. So basically, foreign parents in Japan don't stand a chance.
How do you know that no one's ever got a child back? Have you done that research?
Oh, that's a fact. That's a fact. In 60 years, not one child. Japan is a black hole for international parental child abduction. It sanctions child abduction. And it's a fact that not one child has ever been returned from Japan. When I lived here, if I wanted to take my sons back for a holiday, I needed written permission from my wife. However, in Australia, the laws seem to be quite lapsed, and it's quite easy to remove a child from Australia.
So where are you up to now? What have you gone to the courts at all? No.
No, I avoid the Japanese courts like the plague. I mean, going through the Japanese courts would be like being an African-American in 1930s Mississippi or Alabama with the jurors being members of the Klan. The Japanese courts are extremely biased.
Duncan Holmes, you're a family lawyer. I just wonder what you think listening to that. I mean, that's a very extreme picture being painted of the Japanese legal system. Is it a fair picture?
I think it is. The trouble with Japan is that it really is, as your interviewee says, it's an island to itself. There are so many cultural issues surrounding issues of Japanese nationals wanting to return home, and there's a perception that often there's underreporting of violence in relationships, and when they get home, they are given, the perception is that the nationals are given a really good treatment. And
so how difficult is it to get a child back if they've been taken to Japan?
Oh, well, it's just, it's almost impossible.
Because they're not signatories to the Hague
they're not
Convention,
signatories.
But they've said they're going to sign, yes?
They've said they're going to sign, but as I understand it, we're still a long way off from Japan actually putting its signature on the page. And it will also be a question of what conditions they impose.
Matt, you and your parents have been to Japan a number of times and you're living there now. How often have you managed to see your kids since they were taken 3 years ago?
Well, I came here 4 times last year. I was successful in getting access to my children, but, you know, there are times where I have to risk being arrested or, you know, being called a stalker and actually go to the house and knock on the door. I mean, they're the extremes that a lot of left-behind parents, you know, have to resort to in order to see their children.
Now, you turned up at the house in Japan where your kids are living 9 months ago and you had a friend record what happened. Let's have a look at that footage.
Yeah. Yeah, I contacted you, Hiroko, and you haven't replied to me. Now, it costs us a lot of money to come to Japan. You got to stop playing games, Hiroko. We mean business, okay? I've got a lot of Japanese friends here to help, a lot of lawyer friends, and also parents, single parents in my situation. I'm not threatening you. You just need to start. You need to start taking this seriously, Hiroko, and start telling the truth, okay?
Let me talk to
you. Okay, hold on, one sec, hold on. Okay, check on.
ちょっと聞いてください。オッケー。あなたは毎日私の息子たちに会えない。あなたは毎日自分の息子たちに息子たちに会えない。違う。だから今日もし会いたかったらたくさんお金払わなければならない。違う。もし会いたかったらたくさんお金払わなければならない。違う。そういうことじゃない。
違うじゃない。マッシュ。だから今日ボーリング行きたいんですか。はい。じゃあ、わがままですね。覚えてください。自分の息子いるね。自分の息子いる。母さんはもう行って。日本いつも北朝鮮に文句しています。でも日本同じですね。毎年たくさんたくさん子供たち拉致します。いや、あなたは知らない。あなたは主人持ってないだからね。Please。
You have to understand that your grandmother does not want us to see you.
Now, Matt, we blurred the footage, the faces of your children in that footage because we wanted to protect their privacy. But the eldest in particular was clearly distressed by that scene and by what happened.
Yeah, it's very powerful.
How do you feel about it?
But unfortunately, that's the length that a lot of parents, they have no choice but to resort to that, coming to the house. And it is disturbing to see, you know, the children being affected. But there are so many Japanese parents, and particularly grandparents, that do all they can to prevent just basic access to our own children. And that is, I mean, I watched that footage and it is, I find it rather disturbing. But out of desperation, I mean, that's what we're forced to do.
What do your children say to you about things like that after they've happened?
Well, I spoke to my son last week and he said to me that his mother told him that if I go to the house again with anyone or if I film anywhere near there, the police will be called and I will be imprisoned.
What did he say to you after that footage was shot? I mean, once you'd gotten away and the cameras were gone, what did he say?
Yeah, I don't think he's seen that footage.
But he went through that experience. I'm more interested in what he said to you about that. I'm interested in the child's perspective here. What did your son say to you after all that footage was taken? Did he talk to you about what had happened?
No, he didn't. No, we went bowling, and I think the problem that this affects a lot of children emotionally and mentally, and a lot of their feelings are, hidden. So, no, he didn't. We went bowling after that, and everything was fine. We managed to enjoy the rest of the day.
Aisha and Joe, how did you feel watching that footage?
It's obviously really distressing, and it's quite sad to think that that's the sort of length you have to go to just to see your kids. I know that my mum sort of filled my head with really negative images of my father, and I think that was really difficult for me to understand as a child, so I can kind of understand where his kids are coming from. When I saw my dad, I was really quite confused because I was trying to sort of reconcile the fact that he was, you know, made out to be quite an evil, horrible person, and the memories that I had of him, some of them which were quite good. And it's just really awful that you have to go through those sorts of lengths just to see your children.
Aisha, what was it like for you watching that?
It was really hard. I think all the stories tonight reinforced my fears of you trying to make a really difficult situation right and what the kids would have to go through. I think for me, I don't want my kids to have to go through that confusion. But I don't know how other way to see my kids without them having to go through that.
Is that part of the reason you're holding back a bit, that you're a bit stuck? You don't quite know what to do?
I'm trying to, obviously I want to see my kids, which is really important to me, but it's trying to balance up my feelings with what I'm going to put them through to then see them again. And it's really hard to find a place where you feel okay with that. And I guess as a mother, it's like, I want to keep them away from harm as much as I can. And that means staying away for a bit. Well, maybe that's what I have to do.
So you're caught in a way that you're trying to protect them from something like that.
Yeah.
But that means that you can't see them.
You're in a constant state of confusion. There's how much is enough, how much is not enough, or what it would do to them. I know what their father's probably telling them. So it's like, how do you then balance that out? And when I do come to see them, will they want to see me? Is it going to make it harder for them? So it's trying to find the best solution that you can.
But it's such a big change to your life, isn't it, to have three children disappear from your life like that, virtually overnight. Yeah?
That's right. And then you have to find a new role for yourself. So you've gone from being a mother 24/7 to suddenly having kids but they're not there, and then, but you have to always remember that you have children and trying to maintain that while moving forward.
Are you able to contact them at all? Can you write to them? Are you able to talk to them on the telephone?
I can't call them myself. I have no way of contacting them, so I have to wait for him to contact me, and that is, I guess, when he feels like it. And I don't know when that's going to be. I don't know how long it's going to be for, and he's always sitting there, so it's very hard to communicate.
Jo, how has all of this affected your life? You mentioned this a little bit before. Your relationship like with your parents now?
With my mother, it's been my choice to have quite limited contact with her. A couple of years ago, I went to visit her at her house, and I actually tried to discuss this with her. I tried to ask if she'd regretted it or if she had any feelings about it, and she got quite angry about it. She said that it was in my best interest and that she had no regrets. The entire thing had worked out well, she thought. Basically that she'd done the right thing. And it was really quite difficult for me to accept that. That was really horrible, I think, to hear.
So she didn't really hear you?
No, not at all. I tried to explain how upset it had made me and how hard my childhood had been as a result, and because this is when I was trying to come to terms with it as an adult, looking back. And, yeah, she just basically ignored my feelings. She just claimed that it was in my best interest when it clearly wasn't.
And what about your relationship with your dad?
I think it's definitely affected that. I've got quite a strained relationship, but, you know, things have become a lot better, I think. It's quite good that now I'm back with him. I don't have a lot of that negative influence from my mum constantly telling me that he's a horrible person, which I had when I was a young child.
Why do you think you've got a strange... Do you think you've got a strange relationship,
Ryan? I think strained. No, strained. I just put it down to... Well, I'm hoping to put it down to my friends who've got daughters, and they said they're very difficult between about 16 and 22, so I think I've got about 2 years to go.
There you go, Jo. There's your response. Why do you say it's strained?
I think just because you never really get over it when you're a kid. You're quite easily manipulated and...
So you feel like your head was filled full of negative things about your dad?
Yeah, basically, since I knew my mum, basically.
And you've got to turn that around in your head as a child.
Yeah, and it takes a long time. I've started to do it now. I know that my mum's probably not the best parent.
Vincent, you're a clinical psychologist. You've worked in the family court system for 25 years. How do these situations affect the children? I mean, we hear a lot about the parents and the pain that the parents go through, but what about the kids?
You know, Jenny, I thought it was really interesting watching that videotape, because by pixelating the children's faces actually made them invisible. Mm. And in some ways, listening to everyone talking about their rights and how difficult it is, we tend to lose sight of the children. Inevitably, children who are taken away from one parent are inevitably told negative things about the other parent. They're told that the parent is bad or dangerous, that sometimes they're told the parent is dead. And what is the child supposed to do other than to believe the parent upon whom they are the most emotionally dependent and reliant in that situation? Mm. The outcomes, unfortunately, are really quite poor. You're dealing with children who become traumatised, and even the description of them, they seem to be fine, is, I think, a description that needs to be viewed with extreme caution. That this apparently looking fine and being happy and comfortable in the situation, I think, heightens the suggestion that, in fact, they're very traumatised and they're withdrawn and they're detaching, and... You're not aware of the trauma that they're experiencing.
Well, that's what you said, Cole. Mm. You said they seem to be fine. I mean, yeah. How do you know they're fine?
Well, that's right.
I would question that and caution that with extreme scepticism. They're not fine. And I think what Jo is describing is really the category of experiences that children have. They become traumatised, they become anxious, they become confused, they've lost their family, they've lost a father or a mother, a grandparent, school, society, friends, networks. Depending on their age, how do they make sense of it? If they've met a parent who they've been told is bad, well, what do they do about that? If they're then confronted with a different story, the triangulation becomes an impossible.
But what about a situation like Mary's, for example? I mean, can you understand a parent doing that if they're really fearful for the child's safety?
It's really complicated, and every case obviously deserves individual attention. Along a continuum, you have parents who are acting in a justifiable, protective manner. But the other end of that extreme, you have parents who have formed a delusion and a belief that no matter what anyone says to them, they believe that they have been misunderstood, misrepresented, that the story is not correct.
These situations can be incredibly murky. I mean, there's claim and counterclaim. I know just looking at this program ourselves, you know, you get claims and counterclaims. You get incredible amounts of emotion involved in these situations. How do you view child abduction generally, Vincent, from your position?
I think there is a good case to conceptualise child abduction as child abuse, OK? And some children are probably being abducted in order to be protected. I don't doubt that. But the cases I've been involved in are quite different to that. You have parents who've really lost a sense of understanding their child's inner world. These children are seen as possessions, not responsibilities, that the other parent is treated with contempt. They're not seen as being valuable or valued at all.
Cole, what if there are allegations of abuse, that the parent that's hired you has been accused of abuse? I mean, will you deliver a child to an allegedly abusive parent?
Within reason, so long as they haven't been charged with a child-related offence, so long as they're not a child abuser or a paedophile, but within reason, so long as everything on the surface seems acceptable, yes.
On the surface? I mean, you do police checks on people, for example?
We can conduct some background checks. We can...
Police checks?
No, we don't have access to police files.
So how can you know? I mean, how can you... Just theoretically, how could you know, for example, that it was safe to return a child to someone?
Well, you're never going to know that categorically, sadly.
What if you know that there have been allegations of abuse? Would you still do the job? Say there have been allegations of violence against the spouse. Would you still return the child to that person who's allegedly been violent towards the spouse?
Yes. No, we have done. Yes, we have done. We've returned the child, yeah, based on court orders.
OK, so can you just make it clear for me what the boundaries are with a case for you? What sort of cases... What sort of case would you knock back, for example?
I haven't knocked one back yet. I haven't found one that has any grounds for me to knock one back yet. Dennis Ferguson comes in. He's Australia's most notorious paedophile. Wants his kid back. I probably wouldn't do the job for him, but I really haven't had one yet. I can't really think of the circumstances. Murderers, rapists are all allowed access to their children.
Yep.
That's just fair. That's normal. Just because they've been a murderer or a rapist or committed some violent crime doesn't mean they should be denied access to their children for the rest of their lives.
So you've worked for people like that?
Oh, yes. Yes, I have. Yes. Yes.
Jenny, one of the hardest decisions a left-behind parent has to make is, do I pursue? And if you're looking at it from the interests of the child, look at that video. You can't tell me that child isn't suffering damages. To suggest I can take my child bowling and then all of a sudden all of that stress that child is going to... it's just going to wash away, I just think that's fanciful. People like Aisha make a very difficult decision. I'm going to let go because I don't want to put the stress and damage on the child. These discussions tonight of people saying, oh, I'll just go in and pick up a child and take them away, take them back to Australia, I just think that's lunacy, right? They're in a foreign country, they've picked them up from the school, but they've got to get out of the country. Now, think of the damage that is being caused to this child. So decisions like what Aisha makes, I think that is a child-focused decision, and that's what's best.
But very much at Aisha's expense.
She doesn't want to do it, but she's thinking about her children.
Mm.
But isn't she making the decision in a vacuum where she doesn't know what her children are experiencing, going through, what they want, what they need? And sorry, Aisha, but talking about you...
Yeah, but what guarantees do I have that if I take up your service and have the children abducted or recovered, that then you won't then help the father to take them back? And that's been my concern, is I will do that. Obviously, say I thought about myself, I wanted to get them back. He'll do the same thing back, and when does it stop? And that's been a concern that I've had, is when does it stop?
That is a very valid point, Cole. And I just wonder morally, I mean, are you a gun for hire for anyone?
I suppose we are to some degree, yes, to some degree. Yeah.
There are significant advantages to criminalising international abduction.
What do you think about that, Joe?
It would be quite traumatic for me, I think, as a child, to know that my mother is a criminal.
Tonight we're talking about parents abducting children. Ken, It was 3 years before you were reunited with your son in Amsterdam, mainly because you didn't know where he was for a lot of that time. How much help did you get tracking him down?
Oh, look, I think it's an issue all left behind parents in Australia experience. I think probably a little bit more so in Australia than other countries because of the issues with the legislation. It's an offence under one scenario, but not under the other. And even though it is an offence under the Family Law Act, it's very, very difficult to convince authorities such as the Australian Federal Police that a crime has been committed. They see a difference between the Family Law Act and the Crimes Act, and you're frequently told we can't do anything because a crime hasn't been committed under the Crimes Act.
Mm.
But you know that a federal offence has been committed under the Family Law Act, and from that point on, you know, you're just kind of, you feel as though you're just fighting against every obstacle that can possibly be thrown in your path. The first thing you run up against is a jurisdiction issue. So there could well be people within Australia who know some information about where your child might be. I can't get that as a private citizen. The only people who can get that are people like the Australian Federal Police, but they're not empowered to actually make that investigation.
Okay, Michael, is that right? Is what Ken says accurate? That really it's very difficult to get information?
Yes, I think that is right. It is difficult to get information. One of the advantages of a general Crimes Act statute offence would be that you could engage the Australian Federal Police in finding your child. And if necessary, you could engage Interpol in finding your child. So there are significant advantages to criminalising international abduction. But the trouble is that there are also significant disadvantages as well. Most cases involve, over 70% of cases involve women with small children, who are the primary carers of small children, leaving a failed and very often violent and abusive relationship. They themselves might well be suffering from reactive depression. And one of the problems about criminalising international abduction is that there is a real danger that any attempt to negotiate a return will simply fail because of the fear on the part of the abducting parent that they'll be prosecuted when they return. Similarly, there's also the problem of the possibility that being prosecuted on return would be run inside the Hague Convention proceedings as potentially exposing the children to grave psychological harm on the basis their parent is likely to be prosecuted and imprisoned. So Ken is right. There are distinct advantages to criminalising international child abduction in terms of tracing a child. The problem is that the countervailing disadvantages probably outweigh the advantages.
OK, what to the other people, Ken?
Can I just respond to that? I think the issue there is, I mean, when you start talking about criminalisation, people immediately think of punishment and imprisonment. When I talk about, and when other parents whose children have been abducted talk about criminalisation, we're talking more about a legislation that enables things to be done that simply cannot be done at the moment. I don't think there would be too many parents whose children have been abducted that really want to see the abducting parent sent to prison. That's a last resort, as it is with most crimes in our society. What we're looking for is legislation that enables us to locate our children.
Okay, and you think making it a crime under the Crimes Act would facilitate that?
Yeah.
What do you think about that, Jo? Do you think it should be made a crime under the Crimes Act?
It's something that I'm really on the fence about. The thing that I would be concerned about is that, you know, prison should be a last resort, and it would be quite traumatic for me, I think, as a child, to know that my mother is a criminal and that she has gone to jail. But if it is used as a last resort and if it is an enabling act, then, yeah, definitely.
Aisha, do you have a view on this?
I understand where Ken's coming from in that I would like to see more services available to access the children, find them, but I don't want to see their father in jail, and I see what that would do to them, and that would be absolute last resort. It's not in my mind, but if there's another way to get around that, then that would be great.
Mm. Brian?
I don't think many left-behind parents actually want to see their ex-partner in jail. I think the advantage of what Ken is speaking about is the leverage it gives the parent and also the support. One of the problems a lot of left behind parents face, if they want to proceed, prohibitive legal costs and other costs in trying to get anything done about it. If it was made a criminal act, then the state would have to be prosecuted on their behalf. So it helps alleviate that. There's cases where it's not uncommon where the victim parent is funding, facing legal costs, tens or even hundreds of thousands of dollars, and the perpetrator gets legal aid. And I think that's absolutely outrageous.
The federal government is reviewing the law in this area. I mean, what else would any of you like to see happen? Do you have views about Ken?
Yeah, look, I think, you know, there's a lot of focus on, sort of the response side of things. Yet in Australia, there's virtually no preventative measures in place. And that was one of the issues that came up quite strongly in the Senate inquiry last year. The only preventative measure is really the requirement in Australia for both parents to agree to a passport being issued to a child. So both parents have to sign the passport application. But once that passport's been issued, either parent can leave the country without the knowledge of the other parent. That's the first thing. The second part is if you do have a concern that perhaps your child is going to be taken out of the country without your consent, you can have your child placed on what they call the watch list. Very, very few parents know about the watch list. And the only way you can have your child placed on that watch list is by engaging a lawyer, making a case, making an application to the family court to seek an order for that order to be put in place. It's a very, very difficult process to put any preventative measures in place.
Aisha, when was the last time you spoke to your children?
November last year.
Mm. And you haven't been able to have any contact since then?
No. Like I said, he calls when he wants to. And so I just wait for when that time's going to happen.
Mm. So what happens now with your life? I think, how do you get on with your life?
I think I'm hoping that's going to be, there's a very extreme of I have the kids or he has the kids, and so somehow find a balance in between that. I think when I started off, it was very much about I wanted the kids back because they should be with me, I'm their mother, and I was their primary caregiver before they left. And now it's at the point where I'd like to have regular contact. So they don't have to choose, that's where they are. He's not going to leave right now. So how can we do that in a better way? And so for the moment now, I hope that he'll come to that realisation, either by himself or through the kids growing up, they're going to start asking questions. Mm-hmm. And so I have more hope now that as they get older, there's only so much he can tell them. And then they'll ask more questions and hopefully they'll come and look for me.
Well, good luck.
Yeah, thank you.
And thank you very much for sharing your story. And thank you, everybody, for sharing your stories tonight. It's been terrific. And we do have to wrap it up here now, but you can keep talking online. Go to our website, Twitter or Insights Facebook page. Next week, kids and pornography. What are they watching and should they be learning about it?
Has anybody heard of the term pornography before?
It's when people get naked.
It's where you go in the nude and people take photos of you and put it in magazines.
We'll be back next week. Stay tuned now for Dateline and World News.